I'd like to welcome everybody as we're gathered together. It looks like it's a very beautiful day outside, doesn't it? A couple of announcements as we begin. First, we're gathered together on this day, this Trinity Sunday, remembering, as our Lord shares with us, who He is and what He has done for us. Also, we have a couple of the announcements. Our sister congregation in Robbinsdale, they're going to be installing their pastor today at 3 p.m. So they're having an installation service for a new pastor out there this afternoon. More information can be found in the bulletin. Also, we'll be having an updated church directory that will be coming up very quickly within the next couple of Sundays. So that they will be put into your boxes out there. So a reminder to check your boxes in order to see what might be out there. Last thing that I've got down here, we're going to be having our vacation Bible school in a few weeks here. And so in a very short period of time, it'll be Monday through Thursday this year from 9 until noon. And so especially with this, obviously we could use help, but one of the biggest things is just to kind of take a look around yourself. Could be children, grandchildren, neighbor children that might be able to get a ride in order to come here for our vacation Bible school. Whether you can help to drive or you could drive somebody here, that'd be wonderful too. But just kind of keeping our minds out for who might be able to come to the vacation Bible school coming up here very quickly. Are there any other announcements? All right. I'm going to have Kevin come forward and just give a very short presentation about our food distribution ministry. We're starting our second season coming up here in July. And I think we averaged about 250 every time last night.
Somewhere in that range.
Somewhere along there. But Kevin will explain more about what's coming up here quickly in July, as we're starting our second season of food distribution ministry.
Good morning. When I think about Berea's food distribution, I think about feeding of the 5,000. Last year we had 261 for June, 227 for July, 283 for August, 199 for September, and 217 for October, for a total of 1,187. We're well on our way to that 5,000. This year we will not have Breakthrough Ministry assisting with us. So with that said, it will cost us 3 cents per pound for about 1,000 pounds for the 5 times we're doing it this year, and a $40 delivery fee each time. Here's a fun fact for you. That 1.2 pounds equals one meal. So do the math on how much we'll be giving out. We'll have our food distributions this year on July 16th, August 6th, August 20th, September 17th, and October 1st. With all these 5 food distributions, we're looking at about a cost of $1,000. We can use your help with the food distribution and or the free will door offering at the end of the service today. Help is needed for the food distribution about 7:45 to 1 p.m. Any amount of time that you'll be giving is greatly appreciated. If you have any questions, please ask me and I will give you all the information you need on the food distribution. Thank you.
Please rise. give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have shown us who you are, that you have revealed to us that you are one God, that we worship you, that we praise you, and that you watch over and care for us. And yet you are three persons. Father, who cares and is there for us. Son, who died upon that cross, who by his blood we are redeemed. And the Holy Spirit, who has given to us faith and strengthens us as we walk through this life. We thank you, Lord, that you care over all of our life as you have revealed us as your holy people. In your holy and most blessed name we pray. Amen. Proverbs, the 8th chapter. Does not wisdom call? Does not understanding raise her voice? On the heights beside the way, at the crossroads she takes her stand. Beside the gates in front of the town, at the entrance of the portals, she cries aloud. To you, O man, I call, and my cry is to the children of man. The Lord possessed me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of old. Ages ago I was set up, at the first, before the beginning of the earth. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no springs abounding with water, before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. Before he had made the earths with its fields, or the first of the dust of the world. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep, when he made firm the skies above, when he established the foundations of the deep, when he assigned to the sea its limit, so the waters might not transgress his command, when he marked out the foundations of the earth, and I was beside him like a master workman, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in the inhabited world, and delighting in the children of man. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle text comes from Acts, the second chapter. And here it's Acts 14, verse 8, and then 22 through 36. And what's going on is this is a continuation of Peter's sermon that we read the first part of last week. So last week was the first section going forward of Peter's sermon as he tells to them what's going on. Don't think that this is not what you're thinking. This is the promised Holy Spirit come upon God's people. So now that he's explained what's going on, in these verses is his sermon really directly to the people of Israel that are right there in front of him. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. Men of Judea, and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and give ear to my words. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosening the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by him. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced, and my flesh also will dwell in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life and will make me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on the throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. At this time, we ask all those sixth grade and under to come forward for the children's message. Yep. Yeah, Scarlett's coming up too. Awesome. Okay, you can sit by Scarlett. awesome that God has brought us together today. And today is something, you know what, do you remember from earlier what the service is called? The Holy Trinity. Right. Good job. And Spirit. Oh, you're getting ahead of me. Okay. Good job. We're thinking of the Holy Trinity today. That's kind of a strange word, right? That's something you use every day, right? You're normally just walking down the street or walking around your house and you say, hey, Mom, remember the Trinity, right? No? Anybody else out there? Okay. So, Trinity. What in the world is the Trinity? And you know, people have tried to explain this a lot over time. There was a man who tried to explain it in this way, where he took a clover leaf and he was trying to say, well, you know, there's one clover leaf, but there's kind of three parts to it. And that kind of helps a little bit, but that's not quite the way that God put it. And then I saw on a couple of churches' websites other ways they tried to explain it. Another person tried to explain it like an egg. God the Father is kind of the shell. But you kind of look at that, and really, that means God the Father's broken or something? That doesn't quite fit either, does it? Another person tried to bring up with this idea. God must be like an apple, right? Where you got seeds, and you got apple, and you got the stuff on the outside. And you know what? That doesn't really work very well either. Because it tells us a little bit, but you know what's wrong with each one of these? Each one of these is we're trying to figure out how to explain. And you know what? Why don't we just go to God's Word? Does that sound like a good place to go? Yeah. Instead of trying to think things in our own head, let's just go and sit with what God tells us, okay? Now, if we look up on the screen up there, get over here so I can see it too. It's kind of like a triangle there. You see that? And so you've got a triangle there. And right there in the middle is the word God. And it's just one word there. So how many gods do we have? One God. You got it. Absolutely right. So we have one God. But he shows us as three persons. You can repeat with me. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Right? So, how many gods do we have, everybody? One God, right? And how many persons are there? Three. You're right. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. So, probably the best thing is not to try and come up with all sorts of different ways to explain things. Probably the best is just to go to God's Word, don't you think? And that's how he tells us he is. One God, and yet Father, Son, and Holy Spirit given for us. So right now we're going to have a prayer. So let's all stand up. And we'll hold hands. You can come too. And we'll pray all together. Heavenly Father, Heavenly Father, thank you for showing us who you are. Thank you for showing us who you are. Jesus Christ, thank you for showing us who you are. Thank you for showing us who you are. Promise Holy Spirit, thank you for showing us who you are. Thank you for showing us who you are. God, thank you for showing us who you are. Thank you for showing us who you are. In your name we pray. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Over here. There you go. Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is found according to St. John, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And as as we're reading this, one thing to really note here is, what does the word I am mean? I am is kind of the word given by God to Moses from the burning bush. I am that I am. And if you're going to throw Hebrew in there, Yahweh. I am is really the personal name of God. And as we read through this, note the reaction by the people, by the Pharisees and Sadducees, when Jesus says, I am. John the 8th chapter. The Jews answered Jesus, are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and have a demon? Jesus answered, I do not have a demon, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. Yet I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death. The Jews said to him, now we know you have a demon. Abraham died, as did the prophets. Yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham who died, and the prophets who died? Who do you make yourself out to be? Jesus answered, if I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. But it is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say he is our God. But you have not known him. I know him. If I were to say that I do not know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. So the Jews said to him, you are not yet 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham? Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. So they picked up stones to throw at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. And we sing together our creed.
Thank you.
meditations of our hearts. Be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. You may be seated. Now you might remember from a couple of months back where I was asking for everybody, in fact we had those little sheets where everybody could fill in and finish out the sentence. I always wanted to hear a sermon about blank. I got quite a few different suggestions going in there. And I didn't find a single bad suggestion. Maybe one or two I would word a little bit differently. But I had all these incredibly good suggestions that were brought forward. And with all of these suggestions, one of the suggestions was, I always want to hear a sermon about who is the Holy Spirit. And as I was putting this together, I thought, who is the Holy Spirit? Trinity Sunday, where we're already looking at the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I thought that worked pretty good together there. And so, as we go throughout this kind of not a sermon series, because there's no real connection between all the sermons, but it's a sermon series because they're all asking the same question. It'll be kind of all over the place. I actually had two people put down predestination. So that'll be interesting. But you look here, who is the Holy Spirit? And when we think of the Holy Spirit, he's kind of the forgotten one out of the Trinity. Think it just even with our prayers. A lot of times our prayers are our Father who art in heaven, right? We're praising our Father. A lot of times thinking of that creative hand, the hand that reached down and created us. Or we might start our prayers with Jesus Christ. Christ. Or Jesus, however we want to put forward. I pray that you might watch over me this night. A prayer that Luther put together, started ranking that way. But how often do we have a prayer that says, promise Holy Spirit? That kind of ends up being kind of pushed to the side, doesn't it? We go Father, we go Son, and then we kind of go and just kind of assume Holy Spirit's going to be in there, kind of at work. Anyways, he's there, he's doing his thing, he's making this all happen. But the question kind of comes forward. Who is the Holy Spirit? And so what we're going to do is we're going to look at a number of different places and see what God is telling us about who he is and what he's done. And so starting in Matthew 28, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now, a lot of times when we hear that, we're thinking of our baptism, right? We might think kind of at the beginning of the service, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But that's also remembering our baptism, what God has done, that gift that he gives to us when the water was poured over our heads, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. But you look at how God wants, as Jesus is saying this, just about to ascend into heaven, is when he gives this forward. And he says, this is how you are to baptize. He also says to teach. But here we're looking at this baptism. As we are baptized, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And if he's put the first two persons of the Trinity together there, what does that mean about the third in that series? The same thing, doesn't it? A, B, and C. That this is baptism in the name of our God. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so we're going to do a little bit of algebra today, all right? Everybody excited? Everybody ready for your algebra going today? Here's the basic algebraic equation. If A equals B, and B equals C, then A equals C, okay? So if these two are the same, those two are the same, then they are the same, is how that goes. And so, if the Father is God, and the Holy Spirit does the same thing that the Father does, then the Holy Spirit is God. And that's what we're going to be looking at several times here. You'll figure it out as we go along. And then when you go home, you can say we did algebra today. Sound good? And so we get to Acts chapter 5. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit? And to keep back for yourself part of the proceeds of the land. While it remained unsold, did not remain your own. And after it was sold, was it not at your disposal? Why is it that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You have not lied to man, but to God. And kind of the first thing to look at in Scripture when you're looking at the Holy Spirit is, who does it say the Holy Spirit is? Who does it just call straight out? Who is it? And look here, this is just how it happens in a normal verse. Because here, we're not going to get into the actual text. That'd be a whole different sermon. And nobody suggested this one. But here you run into this. And look at how Luke wrote. You lie to, you are to lie to the Holy Spirit. You have not lied to man, but to God. So there, you got lies going on here. And so as they're lying here, you've not lied to man, but to God. You've lied to the Holy Spirit. So who's that saying that the Holy Spirit is? The Holy Spirit is God. It's just calling him that pretty well straight out. You can also go to 1 Corinthians 3:16. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? And there you get kind of two parts of the Trinity right there. You are God's temple. That means God came down and created you as his temple. And how well do you take care of a temple? You should take pretty good care of it, shouldn't you? But God came down and created you. And who did he put into you? His Holy Spirit. He created you. It doesn't say it here, but in Jesus he redeemed you. And the Holy Spirit dwells in you as his child. Then we go to Psalm 139, verses 7 through 8. And just kind of note here, I said I'm going to be jumping around to Scripture, right? Notice here, the Holy Spirit does not start to show up at Pentecost, does it? The Holy Spirit is how God always has been. Sometimes we get this thing in our head where we start to think, well, the Father was there at creation, and then Jesus, well, that's when you get to about 4 or 5 B.C., and then you get to Pentecost, that's where we finally get the Holy Spirit, right? But you look here, God has always been who he is. He has always been one God, yet Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Whether you're at 1000 B.C., like David, whether you're at 4 or 5 B.C., when Christ, Emmanuel, Jesus, God is with us. But look at 1000 B.C. here. 1,000 years before Jesus gets born in Bethlehem. And King David wrote, "Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to the heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and in the utmost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me." And that's something called omnipresence. Omni, all, presence, present. So all, being in all places at one time. Here we get to our calculus, right? Algebra. Here we go to our algebra. Only God is everywhere, right? So God is omnipresence. God is everywhere. According to the verse here written by David, the Holy Spirit is everywhere. So if God is everywhere, the Holy Spirit is everywhere, what does that mean? The Holy Spirit is God. He is God. That's omnipresence. He is present everywhere. Then we get to the next one. Omniscience. All science, knowledge. That's where our Greek word, or our English word, science, comes from, is the word for knowledge. All knowledge, all knowing. And here I go to 1 Corinthians 2:10. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit, searches everything, even the depths of God. So the Holy Spirit knows everything. Sometimes we act that way, don't we? We act like I know it all. Guess what? We don't. Now the Holy Spirit, He knows everything, even the deep stuff, the depths of God Himself, the Holy Spirit knows. These are all things only the Holy Spirit, only God knows. The Holy Spirit knows these things. Therefore, using our algebra, the Holy Spirit is God. Eternity. How much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? The eternal Spirit. And eternal does not mean from here going forward. Eternal, eternity means that word I am. You remember the word from a little bit ago when we were in the gospel reading? Jesus went forward and He said, before Abraham was, I am. Jesus doesn't say I was, does He? He says, I am. And just with that word and how it all goes, He's saying, I am always in the past, I am now, and I am always in the future. Whenever you might be, before the creation, after the creation, in the new heaven and the new earth, I am. That's why the Pharisees and Sadducees were so ticked off. They were grabbing stones and were getting ready to try and stone Jesus and kill Him. Why? Because He said, I am. And used that personal name of God right there in talking to them. And here we have that promised Holy Spirit. And in that Holy Spirit, the eternal Spirit. Only God is eternal. The Holy Spirit is eternal. Therefore, the Holy Spirit is, come on, you can start saying it, God. And what does He do? We get that word, purify. That's where He comes into our life and purifies us and makes our life closer to that should be pure of our Heavenly Father. Now, it would be great if we could get to the point someday in this life that we were pure, right, and holy. But it's a constant process throughout our life until when our Lord one day will take us, and then we will be completely pure as we're brought before our Lord. But throughout this life, He purifies us in bringing us closer to Him. And here's one of my favorite ones. You get to Genesis 1. And some of you know this old joke. Where's the first mention of baseball in the Bible? In the big inning, right? Did I get enough groans out there? Okay, good. But here we get to the beginning, all the way to Genesis 1. Now, as I said before, remember, God, the Holy Spirit didn't suddenly show up on Pentecost. This has always been who God is. And how does all of the Bible start? Well, Genesis 1, verse 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God the Father, we think of a lot, right? That creative hand of God coming down. He is God. Verse 2. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. So the Spirit of God at the creation, this is before day 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, before He gets into all of that creative process, before He separates the light from the darkness, before all of that happens, there is the Holy Spirit before any of this was created, before any of this was put together. Before the creation, you have one God, and yet you still have the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Who God has always been is who He is today, is who He always will be going forward. What does He do from Titus 3? He saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to His own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit. All one sentence there. And look at the parts in red. He saved us. Who is the one who saved us? God, right? God is the one who saved us by the renewal of the Holy Spirit. So he works through his Holy Spirit to save us. He sends his Holy Spirit to us. By that we are saved. Who's the only one who can save us? God. What does the Holy Spirit do? Saves us. The Holy Spirit is God. Also, divine honor and glory, things that are only given to God, are also given to the Holy Spirit in the Bible. From 1 Peter 4. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. And right there in English, it almost makes it seem separate. But both of glory and of God all refer to Spirit. So the glory and honor of God, the Holy Spirit has that. So if glory and honor only given to God are also given to the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is God. And finally, he has called us to Christ with power. And I love how God put together the Bible. You keep reading it, you keep looking at it, and it's like, this is cool stuff. We began with, remember going back to Genesis 1, you had the promised Holy Spirit here, right? All the way in the beginning. Now that book of Genesis, probably written about 1500-ish, 1600-ish BC, somewhere along there was when Genesis would have been written. Give or take 50 years in there. So that's when you had that being written, the book of Genesis. And the second verse of the entire Bible shares with us about the Spirit of God. Now we go to Revelation 22. How many chapters in Revelation? It's not a trick question. 22 chapters in the book of Revelation. There's actually 20 verses in 22. So almost the last verse of Scripture says, the Spirit and the Bride say, come. At the very beginning, you have the promised Holy Spirit. At the very end, fourth to the last verse of all of Scripture, the Holy Spirit says, come, as he gathers us and will bring us into that eternal home. He bookends the entirety of Scripture with who he is. But this whole idea of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, can be found in the first three verses and the last four verses of all the Scripture. And finally, we come to Romans. And Paul writes in Romans 15, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. God calls us. He says, you are mine. I love you. I take care of you. And as he calls us, he gives to us the power of the Holy Spirit. That as we walk through this life, that as we go through hard times, as we go through trials, temptations, as we go through good times, the Holy Spirit is there. And he gives us the power to walk along as his children. So let's end as we read together that passage from Romans at the bottom of the slide. We read together. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Amen. Thank you.
Grant you peace.